Ok.
Aspetta, ah, ok, accetta, perfetto.
So, good evening again. Thank you all for your presence. I'm very glad to welcome Professor Caterina Carozzi for her second contribution to the series of lectures that we organize in our postgraduate studies program. Yesterday we were about 40 and we had the opportunity to attend an interesting presentation on the management of seismic damages after that the earthquake in L'Aquila. I think you all remember it some years ago. Professor Garozzi explained us how interdisciplinary scientific groups prepared exemplary projects of restoration. Not for individual buildings, that was the idea, but for entire building blocks, and how they fixed the rules to be followed by owners for the restoration or reconstruction of their properties, and what was impressive for at least for me at state expenses. Professor Carozzi had a leading role in this case, in this program, as her specialization concerns theory and practices of historic construction systems. For those of you who were not with us yesterday, I remind that Professor Carozzi is a full professor of restoration at the School of Architecture of the University of Catania. Also, she has worked in restoration projects at many, many cases, among them in the historic city of Matera. And that is where we first met her. She was our host and our excellent guide, I must say, during a scientific travel for the needs of a research program that we had with Claire Palivou some years ago. 2012 to 2015. Caterina, what do you think?
It's time to start, I think.
Again, yes. My warm thanks for your presence here. Yes. Please go on to share your screen.
Okay.
With us.
Okay. Yes.
We are listening.
Come devo fare per farlo partire. Just a moment. No. Ecco.
Okay.
We have a panoramic view now.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Good morning to everybody of you, and thank you very much for your presence here. It's an honor for me. This night, we try to present you something about the city of Matera, and especially about Sassi di Matera. You, everybody, you will know this town, because today is well known, is famous in all the world. But few decades ago, the condition of this settlement was completely different. And it is precisely this aspect that we want to tell you about today. Because it was a complete change that has been taking place in the space of about 60 years. It's very interesting process, firstly, because it has been quite peculiar, unique in Italy. And secondly, because in our opinion, this process deserves a reflection on the meanings of conservation. But before starting, I would like to explain what my connection with Matera is. In 1990, just after my graduation from the Faculty of Architecture of Rome, my tutor, Professor Antonino Giuffre, was called to work in Matera with the aim of giving indication for a compatible intervention for the restoration of these uninhabited houses. So I was called to be part of a group of young people who had to work on the field. In this way, I lived for a long time in the Sassi, and then this study became a part of my PhD thesis, and later on a volume in 1997. Also Costanza, who will give you a part of this presentation, has a special link with Matera, because she worked on the Sassi for her degree thesis 2 years ago. Come si va avanti? Ecco. To begin with, let's see Matera, where Matera is. Not far from Bari, you can see here, in the hinterland of Basilicata. It's very isolated place, and also today not easy to reach from the main Italian communication routes. Let's say to see from above the town. As you can see, the territory is characterized by a plateau cut, but deep canyons where torrential rivers flow. On one of the bank of the canyon rises the city of Sassi. The rises part of the settlement, the Civita, you can see here in the middle, divides the two natural theaters of the Sassi. Sasso Barisano, this is here, and Sasso Caveoso, clearly distinguishable from the expansion of the contemporary city that is in this part. From this picture, the link between the process of geological formation of the territory and the layout of the city is evident. The erosion of the Gravina torrent has given rise to the rocky slope on which the Sassi will be built. Opposite to the town, the unspoiled bank of Murgia Plateau is now a protected natural park and preserves prehistoric settlements from the Paleolithic and Neolithic periods, rock churches, and significant faunal and floral features. The conformation of the rocky slope defines the shape of the city, the two cities' districts. The Civita at the top, as I saw before, and the two Sassi around it, the more closed Sasso Barisano and the more open Sasso Caveoso, both of them following the morphological characteristic of the slopes. In the Sassi impluvium, you can see here and here, there were the grabiglioni that are the collectors of rainwaters and wash water that flowed into the Gravina torrent. Also here you can see in very good way the conformation of the slope with the Civita in the middle and the two Sassi around it. What events brought the Sassi into the light and started the process for which they are now famous? We can divide it, I will show some picture before of the Sassi in the 50s. This picture show you the condition of the city of the Sassi before the movement of the population out of their houses. As you can see, this is the characteristic of this place, where you can see the houses cutted in the rocks, and also building built close to the slope. The condition of the city was of the building, and in this picture you can see the condition after the abandonment by the population. They left the houses in this way, opened and without windows and doors, so they was laid to the weather. And in this picture I will show you the three period in which the process of recovery of the Sassi did. I'm sorry. The first period is when it was realized that the condition of the farm worker was unacceptably poor, and it was decided that the state could no longer allow them to live in unhealthy houses. The decision was made to forcibly empty the Sassi. In the second period, after the emptying out, the problem of the Sassi began to emerge strongly enough to launch a phase of important cultural and legislative work on the issue. The last period started in 1993, when Materia was included in the UNESCO World Heritage List. The road to recovery is open, leading to its designation to as European Capital of Culture in 2014.
Okay, let's retrace the history of the city through the most important happening. In 1902, the Italian Prime Minister Giuseppe Zanardelli visited the Sassi and reported the shameful life condition. Following the special law in Basilicata in 1904, a number of hygienic interventions were carried out, in particular the two streams called Grabiglioni, that had always characterized the development of Sassi, as you can see here, were challenged and paved, thus creating two rather wide roads that connected the whole city. From 1922, as you all know, Italy was governed by the National Fascist Party with Benito Mussolini as prime minister. In 1926, Matera was elevated to the status of county town of Basilicata's second province after the city of Potenza. The city in the following years was used as a propaganda mine, but a few concrete actions were carried on. For example, in occasion of the public work program called Per la più grande Matera, different gattings were realized, as we can see here in black, and also here on the right in these two pictures. And also the new ring road called Via Madonna delle Virtù, that is here, was made, providing a partial solution to the problem of overcrowding. At the end of the Second World War, in 1945, upon the publication of Carlo Levi's Cristo si è fermato ad Eboli, the whole country became aware of the Sassi matter, and the appalling living condition of the population struck the country and its ruling class. Deputy Palmiro Togliatti was the first to travel to the city during 1948 election to see personally the unhealthy places where people and animals live together. He straight away defined the Sassi as a national shame and a symbol of backwardness that Italy and above all workers could not tolerate anymore. The city, indeed, like many other in South Italy, became noted for intractable poverty, poor sanitation, and rampant disease. Basically, a mechanism of overcrowding was occurring within the Sassi, where the population frantically searched for any available space, either underground or above road level, that could be made into a home. Every rock that could be hewn was hewn to make way for a home. As we can see here in this drawing by the sociologist Friedrich Friedman, 1953, animal and people live together, clustering around a central space called vicinato, the courtyard that was the focus of the traditional Stasi life. Following the example set by past national leaders, the Christian Democratic Prime Minister Alcide De Gasperi visited Matera in 1950. And like his predecessor, De Gasperi condemned the cave society and said the state shall bear the cost of rehabilitating the Sasso Caveoso and Sasso Barisano quarters of the town of Matera, and for the construction of social housing, particularly suitable for peasant workers and artisans, in substitution for those currently existing in safe quarters, which will be declared inhabitable and demolished. Finally, in 1952, the government led by De Gasperi promulgated the law 619. Material buildings, so were classified in three categories: buildings to be closed in light gray, the majority of Sassi, buildings in dark gray to be recovered here and also here in Civita, but also in Sasso Barisano, and habitable buildings in black, as you can notice only a few in front of the all Rioni buildings. The law nevertheless did not involve the recovery, but a complete displacement of the population from unhealthy dwellings to the new districts. We talk about 17,000 people. In order to prevent the population or other people from occupying the dwellings, the empty buildings were walled and left to neglect. By assigning their old dwellings to the state property office, the inhabitants got new houses and the promise of a plot of land for farming, paying a very low rent. In the same period, the most important Italian urban planners and architects were involved in the design of new neighborhoods. Among others, Luigi Piccinato was entrusted with the city's master plan in 1953. This general regulation plan gave no answer about what could be the use of the old district. So, as we can see, Rioni Sassi, here in light green, were still a void of urban destination. This master plan, most of all, ruled the city's expansion and the evacuation process of Rioni Sassi. Between 1951 and 1959, indeed, five newly rural villages were built. La Martella, the first one and the biggest one, Borgo Venusio, project by Luigi Piccinato, Borghi Picciano A and B, and the last one, Borgo Timmari. And the forced displacement went on for about 15 years, strongly opposed by inhabitants. And the Sassi were essentially emptied and became a ghost town, edging the new city. La Martella, as I said, was the first rural village, and it was realized starting from 1951, thanks to Adriano Olivetti, an Italian engineer and a key figure in Italian reconstruction. He played a prominent role in bringing Matera, the Materan question, into the debate around architecture and regional planning. derived, let's see the plan of Martella in details. It was derived by the Vicinato concept, and also service building in the center, and houses along the main street, overlooking a land owned. This in opposition to the previous one situation in which the land owned were far away in the country. In 1959, a group of young people founded La Scaletta Association and decided to take matters into their hands and rebel against the government decision. The association was animated by the belief of that Matera was not a miserable city, but one rich in history, which could become a great resource for the whole country. They started a passionate research, documentation, protection, and cultural promotion of the territory. The Repression Church, called Cripta del Peccato Originale, for instance, was discovered by this group in May 1963. Also worth mentioning is the presence during the same years of numerous photographers and filmmakers, both Italian and foreign, who chose Matera for their works. We mention here only Il Vangelo secondo Matteo by Pierpaolo Pasolini. And at the same time, as a consequence of political inaction, houses in Sassi started to crumble or to be eroded until some of them collapsed. But what function had to be attributed to the Sassi? To overcome this question, in 1974, an international idea contest for the renovation of the Sassi was launched. The initiative led to several cultural and political debates and reanimated the interest for the city with the publishing of studies on the evolution and urban development of Matera. 16 projects on what the future role of Sassi could and should be were submitted. For example, here we have the table of a Japanese group that foresaw the presence of a theater in Rioni Sassi. But the contest was won by the architect Giura Longos group, whose project aimed at attributing to the Sassi the just honor of historical center of the town of Matera. The winning group was in charge of preparing four experimental plans. However, due to administrative issues, these plans could not be implemented. The question remained open until 1986. Following the international contest, indeed, the government passed the fifth special law, the law number 771, entitled the Protection and Revitalization of the Sassi of Matera and of the High Murgia Plateau. This law, whose enactment was entrusted to the Council Administration Department, explicitly recalled the result of the contest and declared as a goal to achieve this 4 points: Rioni Sassi as the historic city center of Matera, the restoration of the area preserving the original form of housing and urban planning, the integration between Rioni Sassi and the rest of the city, and also the safeguarding of the environment context, so the Murgia High Plateau, as an inseparable and complementary element to the works of the restoration. The law gave local authorities the power to directly manage the project, With a request to the municipality, it was possible to receive a Sassi building under concession for 99 years, with the condition, obviously, of refurbishing it. The municipality of Matera arranged the 2 years plan to enforce the law. The first biennial plan concerned Sasso Barisano and Civita, and wanted to connect them through the two main squares. So the square called Vittorio Veneto here, and the second square here, Piazza Duomo. And you can also recognize here the ring road, Via Madonna delle Virtù. Here you have two pictures of the present situation. So on the left, Piazza Duomo with the Cathedral of Civita, and on the right, the second square, Piazza Vittorio Veneto. And here we have some of the original drawing with the here Piazza Duomo on the top, the Cathedral, and as you can see here, the main road that connected the two, Via Fiorentini, that was once a Grabiglione. In here we can notice the new connection projected. And on the right, we have Piazza Vittorio Veneto, also with Via dei Fiorentini. And the second biennial program concerned Sasso Caveoso.
Sorry. After all this work did by the municipality, and thanks to the report drawn up by Pietro Laureano, the candidature of Sassi for the list of UNESCO World Heritage Sites was put forward. The objective was achieved in 1993, and in 2007, a revision allowed the protected area to be extended to include the Park of Rupestrian Churches, thus emphasizing the unity of the anthropic system. This was a turning point for the city. In fact, starting from this moment, became very known its cultural essence as a testimony of thousand years old civilization, in contrast to the notoriety of the post-war period when it had been called the shame of Italy. In spite of the enormous step forward in terms both of regulation and ideas, the technical issue of intervening on buildings remained a difficulty still to be overcome. It was precisely in order to respond to this question that the study that would lead to the drafting to the practice code was launched. The situation in which we worked were still of empty houses. And the work was led on the field, first of all, to understand how these houses were built, because nobody studied in detail the measuring organism of the houses, because all the forces were dedicated to other things before. So we started with a very long and precisely documentation in order just to understand how these houses were built. And so we recognize, of course, the first anthropic sign of construction, this one. So the people closed a natural cave with the wall, simply constructing a door and a little openings above the door. The second step, the real construction of something that was like the cave, but with the same stone of the natural slope. So in many cases, they used to dig the cave to construct the building erected close to the entrance of the cave. Of course, we recognize some of recurring situation of houses, and it showed at the same time the beauty of this construction and also how they were built, and also the weakness of this of their situation. Starting from these little houses, step by step, we could understand how also how they were transformed in the years, and also we could pass to more complicated situation because of course the construction are not only simple houses but also as in this case very very big houses and palace with a lot of history inside. These are some of the cases we studied. The second aims was to understand the construction techniques, of course, and also the elements of which the houses were built. And so we studied, of course, first of all, the masonry work, and of course the situation of partial collapse that was spread in the Sassi, in the two Sassi, facilitated us the work. Here some plates of the practice code of the Sassi di Matera. And as you can see, for example, we studied also the composition of the wall, because we could say something also about its safety and the possibility to have safety houses in leaving the construction without change the structure. In that period, we are at the beginning of the 90s, the intervention on masonry construction were made by concrete. Also yesterday, I told you this, in Italy was the most spread technical intervention of refurbishment to apply slab of concrete on the surface of the masonry work to strengthening them. Of course, this was the aim of our work to demonstrate that it was possible these houses could work without this kind of reinforcement. And so for this reason, we studied how the vaulted worked on these piedritti, and also the composition of the forces the thrust that the vault give to the walls. A lot of detail were discovered in this construction techniques, of course, and all these kind of drawings were made because the request of the city was to show to the technician how to manage this kind of construction. Also the detail of the openings and the chimneys and so on were studied. Here something about the weakness and the possibility to crack of this kind of vault. It's very simple that when the wall are not enough thin, the vault could move. The post wall, and you can see, and it was classical to see the crack at the middle of the vault, but these houses, the construction that made these houses well known this problem. In fact, generally these houses has these tie rods that you can see also in the outside of the houses and in the down part of the building there are very very often spurs. The work finished with some suggestion of design to recover these houses and in selecting the most recurrent situation of damage and simply giving some information on what was the techniques that could be used. These are also some detail coming from the book, the volume, and this is all for the practic code. Now we arrive to 2012. A lot of work was done. And this is the situation of the realized intervention in the Sassi and the Civita. You can see in gray the sacche di abbandono. That means the area where is still the situation of degradation. One of these is Casalnuovo, the big one of these. And it's the area studied by Costanza in her degree. We are speaking about here, you can see in the upper picture, you can see all the Sasso Barisano. You can see here the Cathedral Tower Bell and Madonna dell'Idris, and in this part, this red rectangle, and you have down the picture. You can see Casalnuovo.
Nico, questo microfono.
Here. One picture very impressive of the end of Casalnuovo, and you can see that in the upper part there are the building built, but in the down part there is all the system of caves transformed in houses. This was the part in which at the beginning this cave was not used as houses but to product for example oil, wine and something like this, but when the population increased also this part became houses. It's a very, very complicated situation because, as you can see, there is only the entrance and the surface, the inside surface goes down into the rock. So But now that they are empty and abandoned from 60 years, these are just the same as in 60. And there are a beautiful space, of course, full of atmosphere. And so this will be the next step of recovery and preservation, restoration of the Sassi di Matera. And now I would like to show you some of, because of course they did a lot of work in rehabilitation of houses, in supply system, water, gas, and light, of course, but a lot of single project went on. For example, this is Casa Cava. That Casa Cava is a dig, and Maria was there when she was in Matera, and you can see the situation before the restoration work, and also here you can see the surface of the principal level, and with in the project proposal, and you can see all this very big space, ipogeum space. Today, this is during the work of design, and you can see it was a cave. You can see here the cutting of the blocks on this surface. And today is a cultural center with a little auditorium where they have music and so on. And also here there is Maria that is listening me explain something about I don't know what, because there are a lot of little spaces that could use for a meeting and presentation and so on. Another interesting project is that of Casa Noa. It's open recently in 2014, and it is on the Civita, in the upper part of the city. And it was a simple house of middle class people in the beginning of the 20th century, and it was donated to the FAI. Centro FAI is is an association for the preservation in Italy. And it was restored in Fondo Ambiente Italia and transformed in a museum, reconstructing the local of the houses, but also transforming it in an information center where you can see the history of the city of Matera before starting your tour on the city itself. Finally, after take care of the Sassi di Matera, a lot of work was done on the natural park, because it was one of the aims of the 1986 law, and so they worked a lot to link the park to the city. And today the tourists used to visit the city, but also a lot of rupestrian churches that are open in the Parco della Murgia. the condition of the city is now completely different, is transformed from 60 years ago. And finally, in 2019, it was this big nomination for Matera Cultural City, European City. What we can see about this, it's a very incredible work, an incredible process that this city passed. Now the problem is not too vast all this work because of this large number of tourists that every year goes there. It's a question that the city is facing in this time, also because the resident that came back in the Sassi recently in the last 5 years decrease just to leave a place to touristic accommodation like Airbnb, hotel, and so on. This is the question on all the city that are attractive like touristic place. But we will see in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you both. Indeed, it's a magical place. It sends you many centuries back. But I cannot imagine us, two buses of students in the surrounding roads, streets. Because the streets are narrow, I'm not sure that with all these people I can see that visit the city now, I'm not sure what is going on there at present. When we went in 2014, maybe.
14, yes.
Yes, it was quiet then.
Yes, it's completely different now because the phenomenon started just in 2014. Because when you came, it was not already appointed as European Capital of Culture. Yes. It was some months later that.
Yeah, and then there still were restorations in progress, so we could see the works. Yeah, very interesting, really.
The situation now, okay, 2 years of COVID, no tourists, of course, but in 2019, it was impossible to go there. The prices were double, three times that before, and also the services for the tourists were not sufficient, of course, because too much people in too short time, of course. So the city was not ready to have this
accept all kind of people, maybe. I don't know if there are enough hotels, enough accommodations to stay.
This is the problem now. In 5 years from 2014 to 2019, the work went on only to have accommodations, more places for tourists to and restaurants, and also this is very different now. If you go today in Matera, You saw a lot of shops and cafe and restaurant spreading the sassi, not very good, very well placed and realized, of course.
Yeah, because what was the different sense with this town was that you had the impression that it was deserted.
Yes.
You didn't see many people. It
yes,
but deserted.
Yes, yes.
Lonely.
Yes, but and I think this is the pity because it was the real the real attraction of Matera, yes. Of the Sassi, because Matera it's a lively city, of course.
Yes, of course.
But now it's not a good condition. But you know, when the economic issue enter in a city like this, it's very difficult to stop and to manage this this kind of process of situation. So
my question is, Caterina, is there some period, any period that we could approach the city without having so many people around?
I don't know. I don't know, because after these 2 years, we went with Costanza in Matera
in February.
In February 2019. 2020, just before the closing,
the lockdown.
The lockdown, yes, so 2 weeks before, yeah. 2 weeks before,
and
it was quite
sí.
No tourist, so maybe the best period is in winter, in February. Passato.
What about May or Easter? Possible,
no,
I suppose.
Impossible also for the coast. When you went there, where did you live? I don't remember.
May Day. It was the May Day.
Yes, but where did you stay? In
Sassi, Albergo Sassi.
Ah, ecco. Impossible.
Yeah, it was empty.
Yeah.
Almost empty, yes.
No, now it's impossible. It's impossible.
Maybe if one stays in the modern city and goes to visit the Sassi.
Yes, yes. Maybe, cheaper. And how many people are you
Maria
think?
Maria just said 2 buses.
No!
Laughter all the way. 100 people.
Oh,
100 people. Difficult.
Oh.
Camping in Murgia.
Sì. Some caves.
In the opposite countryside, maybe. In the caves.
Yes, in the caves. There are a lot of places there.
So let's come to the discussion. If there are any questions, please. For the speakers.
May I?
Yes.
I cannot see hands. Let me see.
Can I speak, Mrs. Aragadaki?
Martina, come on, Martina.
Ne, ti kanete, kalispera.
Kalispera.
Respondi tu.
Thank you for the presentation at first. I've been there twice, actually. It's my favorite city so far from the ones that I have visited. And it was in 2008 and 2011, so it wasn't crowded at all.
Yes,
it was
yes.
Completely different. What I was going to ask you was, you showed some pictures at the beginning
the Grabiglioni that you mentioned.
Yeah.
Was it the place for the waters from toilets and stuff to run through?
The wastewater.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The wastewater, yes.
The wastewater, yes. Yes.
Okay.
That, so that were on the air, of course.
Open.
Hmm? Open, yes.
It was open.
Okay. Makes sense.
And they went in the big torrent, Gravina, down there.
Okay. My other question was because I remember there were some places actually in Sassi that were occupied by locals. I mean, yes. It wasn't hotels and stuff. I remembered the second time I stayed in a place in Sassi, in a bed and breakfast. And it was a typical place inside a cave, something like that, mixed cave and walls.
And constructed.
And I remember the humidity because yeah. it was obvious. So I was wondering, is this a reason for people not to occupy the place because of the conditions?
Today,
yeah.
No. Today, all these problems are solved. But the question is that it's not easy to be a resident in Sassi because there are no shops, no service. Nothing, no service at all for the daily life, of course. And so you need to walk. So
yes,
it's difficult because you know there are only Grabiglioni are now the road for carts. So it's impossible to go there by carts.
Okay. And also carrying your luggage is even more difficult than in Venezia.
Yes. More difficult than in Venezia, but this is very common in all historical centers in Italy that are on the slope. We are full of this problem. For example, in Perugia, they choose to have the mechanical stairs to help this, or also in Siena, because this situation is very, very common. Of course, the question of the tourists do not help to preserve the area, of course. But in this moment, the city wants very much to have this economy on this because a lot of place or to job came out from this new new target of the city. So it's difficult. While in Rome, there is a very big historical center that you can have a lot of tourists, but the city doesn't worry about this because it's big, a lot of places, cars, very like in Paris. I mean, in the big city, it's a different the problem. But in the case like Matera, it's very difficult. It's very difficult. But
one more question, because you mentioned also at the beginning that when they abandoned the place,
yeah,
it was left without doors and windows.
Yeah.
Did they remove them on purpose to move them to their new houses, or
they yes, because also they were very, very, very poor, and also for this reason the municipality closed with the wall a lot of them, because they don't want to go away. Of course, they were very very linked to this district. Of course, it was a pity. I remember when I was there working, you could meet people that were living in the Sassi before 60, and they spoke with you crying because of this. It was very impressive. And also, there are some pictures in books that show these people in the new houses in La Martella, on the other villages. And they didn't know about the toilet, for example, and in the come si dice vasca da bagno, in the toilet they put in the basin the ground with the herbs to like because they didn't know at all.
Small garden.
Like basilico, oregano in the toilet. So it was a pity. But now Maria knows that I have very good friends in Matera.
Yeah, and, how is Gigi? Is he proceeding Gigi with his activities with music?
Yes, 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 with music and yes. And the houses are very, very beautiful because you have these very high spaces with these vaults, and it's very beautiful. It's also the small houses are these very impressive spaces.
Casa Cava was an exemplary restoration. I liked it very much.
Yes.
With all these contemporary materials, they were so much proper in this case, yes, among the stones.
There are a lot of very very good operation. Then there are the others not so good, of course, but it's
the amount of the designs you elaborated there was impressive. Because it was a great place.
Yes.
To start.
Yes. Yes, no, yes. Ma, when I was there for this work of Codice di Pratica, nobody wanted to go in the Sassi. Uh-huh. It was completely empty, and all the houses were opened without without windows and doors. And it was very, very incredible. Also because it was wonderful, of course, but it was like if the city had, a border, a closed border dividing the city from the Sassi. Then little by little, I remember that the water was not arrived in the Sassi, and there was a tube, a plastic tube that goes from the above of the city to down to have the water. It's an incredible history, because today it's it's a madness to move all these people from the houses, but there were a very big problem. This problem is not only it was not only in Matera, of course, but in the other part they did not like this. It became in that period, I don't know, you know, of course, because we were in Italy in the 50, at the beginning of the 50, in March for the reconstruction. A lot of money came from USA, the Piano Marshall and so on. So there were a lot of, also Italy maybe could demonstrate that they wanted to change. And I think a lot of reason decided to do like this. But it is very interesting.
Are there any other questions, please? Technical questions, maybe, about the restorations, etc.
I wanted to ask something about what Martina started to say about the humidity.
Yeah.
I was wondering, because these houses that are cut rock, they have like, the more they have many rooms cut into the rock, I guess that the humidity conditions are worse. And they might be habitable for people that lived like 100 years ago, but now if somebody was called to live there in a long term and not in an Airbnb situation, short-term living, I guess that this could be a really big problem. And I wanted to ask you if you have tackled this issue in the technical guide, or
yes,
what your thoughts are about this?
Yes, yes. Oh, okay. There are two things. One is the humidity. Okay, that you can solve with technical intervention, of course. But the other thing is that you cannot live in a cave very long and very deep in the rock, not only before humidity, but also for the air, for the lack of openings.
Ventilation, yes.
Yes, and light. So, of course, not only the Sassi could be again houses. This is clear. So a selection, but in this moment the tourist wants to stay in the caves. this is incredible, and. Because there is a partial information about the culture of this of this city, and the most easy to pass is the cave houses. So
for one week it's splendid, I must say. Because you don't feel cold, there is heating.
And then the humidity, it is not a very big problem because this rock is not full of water. It's not.
I think that's
yes. There Sandorini is a little problem.
Santorini, I think, is worse because it is the nature of the asphalt. Mm-hmm. The soil.
They're not so deep in Santorini, though. Yeah. They're not so deep.
No.
Yeah, yes. Here there are very, very, very deep, incredible.
And
incredible.
Some of them had many, many rooms in a row, so ventilation could be impossible.
Ventilation is the problem. Yes. Okay, you can afford the ventilation, but it's not easy to live there. For this reason, they decided to evacuate the people because they had the habit to live in this, and also with the animals together. Bene.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Aleka?
Nah. Yes, some remarks I want to make.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for the for reminding us of Matera, because it is an extraordinary place. Second, I have to congratulate you, engineers, for having to do with constructions and working on them without computers. That's a very big difference, which means that you had to have a kind of special way to present even your work with axonometric views and axonometric sections and every possible way to reconstruct the place, the forms, and the forces on walls and even rock, everything.
Mm-hmm.
My general impression, even after today, when you presented us with the situation nowadays, is that in my mind, since the 50s, the Matera is a huge project for everyone.
Yes.
For everyone.
Yes, for the community, yes.
For the community. And in my mind, it is, let's say, for the Sassi, it is a forced let's say, gentrification of the
yeah.
Because as far as I know, the new small towns, the new villages that were well executed and well designed and having in their mind that they were farmers and not just of another profession, they were not successful. Even though architects did their best, they were some of the best architects that took,
yes.
they made architecture there.
Yes, yes, it's true.
Spina, for example.
O Quaroni, yes.
Yeah. Very, very nice built, but people were not happy. They were not happy even with, let's say, the community centers, the center of the community that was presented to them. They were actually, they were liked to live in a dense place, not in open spaces. They were accustomed to dense places.
Yes.
So that's a problem. And that is a problem. Tourism is a problem everywhere. Everywhere. They're good up to a point, tourists. After a certain point, they're a very annoying thing. They're distorting things.
Yes, it's true.
You know, Thessaloniki, it's a problem nowadays. Everywhere you see is a hotel, a hostel, an Airbnb, and things like that. And what about the inhabitants of the city? Where are they going to stay? That's I think, the problems that we're faced today in many, many places, and we will have to think about that. I'm wondering, what is Matera producing now? What are the products? Sculpture.
No, the
culture from rocks.
The
souvenirs.
No. The idea was that it could be the capital of culture in the south of Italy, and in fact there are a lot of exhibition, important exhibition, but of course this is not enough to have an economy on this, so the city wanted very much in this moment this very heavy tourism and this amount of visitors. This is the problem, and when I speak
in these years when I spoke with friends in Matera, all of them wanted to that this situation continued, because they told us, okay, but now our young people, our children can work here in Matera, not to go outside, abroad. And it's a problem. Yes. It's a problem.
There is a university there, part of the Basilicata University. Yes. I think is
they have a faculty of architecture. Yes. And some I don't know if law or something else, but there is also a school of the central ministry of culture. Uh-huh. And there is a school for restoration,
of course. Yeah. Of course,
but it's new, it's 10 years old, and that all these things contributed to the recovery of the city in terms of culture. This was the big idea, the principal idea of the all this big project.
I have the feeling that if the project started, let's say, in the 50, 55, something like that, it's an ongoing project for the city. It has not solved all the problems, but one has to continue to deal with that as a problem, as an economic or a social problem or something like that. Structures finally found a path to their solution, but that's not all.
The impression I have in this moment is that all the thing of all the works they are going to do are for tourists in this moment. Yes. Not for the city, not for the citizen. So this lead to again to separate, like when the Sassi were overthrown. Yes. The city from the Sassi in different way, but the treat is that we could complete the circle and come back in different way, but in let's say the same situation. I don't know if
you're right,
but I think that these are very, very complicated and also very, very interesting processes. It's very good to observe all the situation from the beginning to the present day, because you can observe differently the things.
Anyway, Matera is the finest, let's say, example for a postgraduate course like ours to visit, because it's a multi-layered city. Mm-hmm. With every problem that can,
yes,
think of.
So, yes.
It's, yes, a very good trip for us. So have us, let's say, as the last tourists.
Caterina, I remember you saying that you have very good technicians in the very restorations.
Good. In Matera?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
In the restorations you had shown us, you mentioned how capable were your technicians.
Yes, it's true. It's true. Because they started this process, they formed a class of technicians, very good, not only the technician, but also the enterprises that realized the it was a global approach that they used to in that time. I mean, in the between 80 and the end of 20 years from 80 to the end of the century. Now the things are completely changed, of course, again, because, but.
Maria? Θέλεις να κάνεις κάποιο σχόλιο?
Δεν.
Πάμε να κάνουμε κανένα project εκεί πέρα.
Thank you very much, Caterina.
Grazie a voi.
For both of you. So, it was very interesting. And thank you also for the opportunity, as Aleka said, that remind us of Matera and the atmosphere and the good time we spent there. And the discussions we had and all the things we saw. So I wanted to, I wonder, this kind of, let's say, the effort of rehabilitation of an abandoned historic settlement, like Matera, it needs the, let's say, a lot of forces, a lot of people, the municipality, the state, and the, I don't know, private investors, I don't know. But what happened in Matera? Which was the procedure that financed the whole project, the whole...
Yeah. The law that Costanza told you, the 771 of 1986, was a special law, the final special law for Matera, and it funded all these operations. So the municipality had money from the government, the state, to just for the rehabilitation. And also the situation was simplified because the movement of the inhabitants in the new villages permitted to the municipality to have the property of the Sassi. Oh, okay. So the first biennial program was dedicated to, I remember these faces because I was there, was dedicated to realize, let's say, the infrastructure, the line of water, of light, gas, and so on. So they worked on the public space, first of all, and then every time was the municipality, eh? And then they started to do work of improvement of the structure. And after this, finishing these two works, they started to give to people, if you want to ask, if you wanted to ask a house in Sassi, you could go there in the municipality and tell, I want to this house, and you have to bring the resident to live there as for informal way, and you have to sign a contract in which you could sure that you will finish the work, so with your money, and the house will be should be yours for 99 years. After that, 99 years. After that, after these years, the municipality could ask you a rent, an annual rent. So it was a very, very good condition to manage this rehabilitation. I want to say this, it's clear that the problem was very big, of course, but this law permitted to the municipality not only to do this, but also to form technicians, to have a special office to manage this restoration. So it's a very big. There is another case in Italy. That is where I work in Siracusa. Siracusa, the historical center is like an island, is Ortigia. Mm-hmm. It's the Ortigia. Greek Ortigia. Mm-hmm. Also Ortigia had a special law in the same years. But there, because it was not empty, of course, but but the house is
even more difficult if it's not
more empty. Difficult, but in that case, the state give the money to the rehabilitation to the property. If you add a house in Ortigia, you can do the request and the municipality give you the money to do the works, the restoration works. Different management, but the same results. And a lot of money of course.
I can imagine.
So. But yes, but the also in Matera now, the value of these houses is higher, much more higher than before.
Yes. So have you any idea? Two questions. The first, this plan of the municipality has also thoughts about the uses. They say, for example, only for residents, or you can have a small shop or a small office.
Yes. There was a plan for residential buildings and for services, and but of course the problem of the shops is that the situation is too much difficult. You can, in fact, when you go there, you see that the only shops are on the Grabiglioni Street, because you can arrive there to carriage the duty. It's if not, it's too difficult. In last years, I saw that with the arrival of visitors and tourists, some shops for souvenir arrived also in some little square in the middle of the Sassi, but not more than this. So.
An architect, for example, could go there and have his
office. Yes, at the beginning, there were young people offices, but then with the arrival of the tourism.
So another question and then a remark or a wish. The other question is, have you any idea how the cost of the restoration is more or less? For the square meter, for example, it's accessible or it's very high.
I don't know because they divided the structural was made by the municipality and the finishing from the single people. So okay. I have no idea, but I know that for this reason a lot of artisans realized for example windows and doors, and because the municipality give to the owners, the people who lived in Sassi, some guide to have the same doors, the same colors, and so on. And so a little economy of these artisans came out. When I spoke with some of them, it seems to me not so costly.
Yeah, I can see that. That's why I made the question, not to buy a house there, but just to
have, yes,
just to know.
Another wish. Maybe we can change a little bit the idea of a study trip and go to Syracuse.
Ah, sì, no, I want to propose this. It's much more. In this moment, it's easy, easier than Matera, and I am sure that you will like very, very much.
Ah, good option.
So you propose that we come to Syracuse?
Yes, by plane.
And there are a lot of problems some also in Syracuse. So for didactic purpose, it could be very good too.
So I have to see a lot of hearts arising. You know, Maria, you open your heart, please.
How do you arrive in Syracuse? Which way?
You can by plane, yes.
Plane to where? To Catania, maybe?
Yes, to Catania. Sì. Margherita is from Catania, so she travel.
We have the connection also.
Yeah.
Va bene.
Okay.
Grazie.
Thank you very, very much.
È stato molto bello, grazie molte.
A lei.
Τελειώσαμε, παιδιά, δεν υπάρχουν άλλες ερωτήσεις.
Κάποια άλλη ερώτηση?
Δεν βλέπω χεράκια.
Ονειρεύονται το ταξίδι στις Συρακούσες, μάλλον.
Ναι.
Καλησπέρα σας. Good afternoon, Mrs. Carocci. I was not able to hear by the beginning, so... I hope that I will know more from Maria and Elena about the technical problems of this kind of restoration. But as you continue to speak about the gentrification of the place, as always happens, I wanted to invite people who are listening to you that there is the great difference to understand what is happening in that place is to watch the Pasolini's Vangelo Secondo Matteo, and then watch the last 007, which shows this kind of
bravo.
That's true.
So the thing is that in the middle between that film and the new film, there are the intellectuals who thinks to do something good for the place, but by then, the capitalism is
that what
reigns, and we speak against tourism, but by then we serve tourism. And I see it from our work in restorations that by then we serve tourism, and our governments want that. We like to do our work, and we enjoy that, and we think that we do well for the places and the monuments. But by then, 007 is that what wins. In any case.
È vero. È vero.
Nikos is a professor in Chania, in Crete, in the Polytechnic School of Crete.
And he has just won a place in the Ekdromi. You're invited.
You're very welcome to come with us.
I was speaking some months ago with a professor from the School of Matera. She's called Antonella Serra. No.
But
she's a technician, I think. But really, I think that what would be important for us in Greece, if we could have an exhibition where you can show us the drawings and showing us the problems and the analysis and all the work that has preceded the final works. And that could be interesting to see, not only to go around Matera, I think.
This is and a good job for you, Nikos.
An exhibition in Thessaloniki would be nice.
I propose that you organize that exhibition in Canea, in the CAM,
in
and
CAM.
Then you send it to us in Thessaloniki.
So, okay, please send me mails and telephones of Katerina Karocsi.
Oh, sure.
Because I had no possibility to make me understand by the School of Matera.
Okay.
I mean, I think that Katerina has done the work.
Katerina so has hundreds
to speak
of,
with her and only with her.
A very, very interesting volume of material to be exhibited. As
I think that would be interesting for both of our parallel studies.
Okay.
Okay.
Katerina Nikos has a very, very nice exhibition hall that was before a Venetian arsenal in Canea.
I know Canea, bellissimo.
Yeah. So
Costanza and me,
you agree?
Organize the exhibition for sure.
Okay. Okay. So that is a good idea, and I hope we can be in touch nextly. And you can explain me how much.
Okay, I send you all the contact
okay,
information.
Thank you, Maria.
Yes.
Okay. That was very useful. Thank you.
Grazie.
Buonasera. Buonasera.
Ciao. Ciao.
So I think we can close here. I would like to thank everybody for the participation. Thank you very much, Katerina and Costanza, for your presentation. It was a nice trip. It was a wonderful serata. Oggi. Thank you very much.
Grazie. Grazie a voi.
Ευχαριστώ για την ωραία βραδιά.
Bye.
Η επόμενη παρουσίαση, για να πούμε και τα προσεχώς, θα είναι από τον κύκλο της ΕΛΕΤ. Δεν είναι εδώ ο Κώστας ο Τοκμακίδης να το πει. Η επόμενη διάλεξη θα είναι από την ΕΛΕΤ. Θα πάρετε τη σχετική αφίσα και θα ενημερωθείτε.
Νομίζω ο Βασίλης θέλει να ρωτήσει κάτι.
Θέλετε κάτι, κύριε Κονιόρδο?
Όχι, όχι.
Νομίζω έχει γίνει πάντως η αφίσα και θα πω. Ναι, ναι.
Ήταν πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα η παρουσίαση και την ευχαριστούμε πολύ.
Τα σχέδια. Ήταν εξαιρετικά τα σχέδια.
Τα πλεκτικά.
Γι' αυτό ο Νίκος τσίμπησε αμέσως.
Έμα.
Λοιπόν, καλό σας βράδυ. Ευχαριστούμε πολύ.